real pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you for trusting me with your audience, your customers. You have heard a lot about machine learning today, and I'm up here to explain a little bit about what that means. So, I've written some books. Yes, in 1993, I saw the internet for the first time and thought, that's going to change marketing. So I started writing books. 1995 was marketing on the internet, then advertising, customer service. In 2000, it was about analytics, because my opinion was that this kind of website or user interface was better than that kind of user interface, but that was my opinion. If we can measure it, then we'll know the truth. So that is when I founded the Marketing Evolution Experience. That audience created the Digital Analytics Association, made up of digital analysts. So it is an association for you. But 2 years ago, there was this thing called artificial intelligence. And so that required yet another book. So artificial intelligence is pretty broad spectrum. And I want to make sure there may actually be data scientists in the room. So I want to be very careful. I am not here to teach you how to be a data scientist. That's not my role. I want to teach you how to use data science in marketing better. I want you to be able to talk to data scientists logically. I want you to have enough information so you can have a good conversation with them. So why is this important now? And the answer is multiple, but it mostly is the power of the computer. First of all, it requires a great deal of data. And it turned out that big data was not big enough. We had to have clouds worth of data for it to be enough data. And now we have that, but we also needed more compute power. We didn't have enough CPUs, central processing units. They weren't powerful enough to do it. But what was useful was GPUs, graphical processing units. So thank you to the gaming industry for giving us compute power so that we can run these models, which mathematicians have been playing with for a long time. And then finally, open source. All of the data science, all of the algorithms are available for use. They're being invented and posted online every week. So everybody has access. Now, how do we make that useful? Well, that's tough. So I want to start with what is artificial intelligence and how does it work without the mathematics? What is it good at? Why do we care? And then what is it good for? How can we use it for our own business? First of all, definition. What is this stuff? It is not what you see in the movies and on television. It is not general knowledge. It's not replacing a human being. It is very powerful for a very narrow purpose. So don't think about robots taking your jobs. That's not going to happen. But AI covers a lot of areas. So for instance, natural language processing, being able to understand speech. First of all, just recognizing that this is speech and that's just noise. It can recognize the difference. It can turn speech into text, text into meaning, and then understand and respond. That's very powerful and very difficult. We want it to recognize speech. We don't want it to recognize speech. That's a tough one. It's hard for humans. It's hard for computers. Then there's computer vision. Can you recognize what's in the picture? Is that a cat? Yes. Is that a cat? Well, yes. Is that a cat? No, that's not a cat. So this is a challenge. Is that a woman on a flying carpet? No, it's the shadow of a different flag. Okay, it just takes a minute. And my all-time favorite, is it a chihuahua or is it a muffin? There's some funny-looking dogs there. So we're using it now for facial recognition. You can turn on your phone just by looking at it. We can see who you are. When I was coming... where was I? Leaving the United States to fly through Frankfurt, I had to step up in front of a camera so that the security people could see if my face matched my passport. So we're using it to get on airplanes now. And robots, because everybody loves robots, right? Self-driving cars can't happen soon enough. And it's a challenge. Can I understand what I'm seeing in real time as it's moving? Should I drive around it? Will it get out of my way? That takes a lot of compute power. But mostly robots. They're the ones we love. And you've seen probably the Boston Dynamics. This guy is scary looking, but he's also agile. So he can jump really high. But then the big deal is, can he do a backflip? Oh, yes. So we've got natural language processing. We've got ability to talk to our computers and our phones. We have computer vision, self-driving cars. But I want to talk about machine learning, because that's what we're going to use mostly. Now, machine learning is a different kind of programming. That's all. So where do we go from? We start with, I'm old enough to have worked in Fortran and COBOL. And whether you're doing C++ or JavaScript or writing things in HTML5, it doesn't matter. It's still specific instructions to the computer. And you tell it exactly what you want it to do. And if it doesn't do it, it's a problem. So that's logic. Do this, do that. If this, then that. Make it happen. Now, a mathematical model, something you've also used a lot, it's called an Excel spreadsheet. You're creating instructions, giving it values, and then changing things along the way to make it interesting. Then we get into predictive analytics, and we can get our statisticians involved, creating very complex models, which is a way of plotting out what is the data and where is it headed, and make a prediction about where it might go. That's predictive analytics, which is very powerful, requires a statistician, requires building a complex model that's fragile and doesn't scale very well. And then we get to machine learning, which looks at the data itself. Oops. It looks at the data itself to create the model. It creates its own model by looking at the data, and then when new data comes in, it can change its mind. It is the ability to adapt. Intelligence is the ability to adapt to change. Now, that should be an indication of how amazing the human mind is, because you can actually read that, and it's not even in English. The computer, we're teaching it how to learn. So that's artificial intelligence writ large, machine learning a little bit, but now I want to drill down. How does it work? Well, three kinds of machine learning, three flavors: supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement. And as a marketing person, as a business person, this is valuable to understand so that you can have those conversations with people when they say, oh yes, we use machine learning. Well, which kind of machine learning are we talking about? So, supervised. I know the answer, and I'm teaching the machine. I'm giving it lots of labeled data, lots and lots of examples to say, yes, that's a dog, no, that is not a cat. Yes, those are friends of mine. And I explain, and it listens. Now, if I am a small child, and I wanted my parents to teach me, a cat walks into the room, and I say, kitty cat. They go, yes, that's right. And another cat walks in. Kitty cat, yes, that's right. And then a puppy walks in, and I say, kitty cat. It's like, no, that's a dog. And I'm very upset, because I built a mental model of the world, and now I'm wrong. And then two more dogs come in, and two more cats, and now I can tell the difference. With computers, 100,000 examples of cats are necessary. Because it's not using reason, it's not using common sense, it's looking at pixel by pixel. It says, well, first of all, I need labeling, okay? So let's tell it, yes, these are cats, very good. What do cats have in common? Well, if I look at that picture, they have these pointy things on the top of their head and almond-shaped eyes, and they're all sort of looking in that direction, and I have no idea what that is. It's not a cat. I want the computer to tell the difference between a wolf and a dog. So what do? You give it lots of labeled data. Where do you find wolves and dogs? Google Images. They're all labeled. So 100,000 dogs, 100,000 wolves, and it says, this is definitely a wolf. Well, no. I understand why you think so, but no. Let me show you 100,000 pictures of huskies, and now you'll know the difference. And it says, okay, got it. What about this? Oh, this is definitely a wolf. What? Why do you think so? Well, every other picture you gave me, the wolf is standing in the snow. So that's a wolf, right? It's not logic. It's not common sense. It's statistics. So we have to be very careful that we understand the limitation of machine learning. So that's supervised. Unsupervised is where we don't know the answer, but we have a lot of data. So show me a pattern. Show me something interesting. Show me a correlation or an anomaly. Machine is great at that. So it says, people buy online more when it's snowing outside. Yeah, I knew that. Not a big aha moment. I mean, the computer is correct, so we won't get angry at it, but I've built that concept into my models for the last 15 years. No big surprise. Then it says, you know, ice cream causes drowning, because when ice cream sales go up, drownings go up too. It's like, not really, there's something else going on you're not paying attention to. Well, shoes cause headaches, says the machine. Now, this I know from personal experience. Every morning I wake up wearing shoes, horrible headache, terrible headache. So I know they're right there. And then they claim Nicolas Cage is a monster and they have proof, because the number of people who drown by falling into a swimming pool correlates with films that Nicolas Cage has appeared in. We have to stop this man. So the machine will point out the correlations. We have to decide if there's causality there. Okay, supervised, you know the answer, you teach the machine. Unsupervised, you have a pool of data and you ask the machine to tell you something interesting. Then we have reinforcement. Reinforcement is, there is no real answer. I want to put the right message in front of the right person at the right time. There is no absolute right. All there is good outcomes. So if the outcome I'm looking for is better, then give the machine a numeric reward. If the outcome is worse, give it a numeric demerit. So every time you do something more like what I want, yay, do more of that. Send more people to my website. Have more conversions for every email that goes out. So the machine needs a lot of data, a very specific task to accomplish or problem to solve, and some sort of agency over the environment. The machine needs data, a goal, and control in order to detect which data is the most predictive, the most interesting, make a decision or a recommendation, and then change its mind when new data comes in. So it needs data, a goal, and control to detect, decide, and revise. So is it really good at this stuff? How good is it? And what kind of stuff, where should I use machine learning? And the answer is when you have high dimensionality and cardinality. Everybody got that? Very straightforward, right? How many data scientists do we have in the room? Okay, so the five of you go, yeah, that's true. And everybody else is, Jim, I don't remember my statistics class. Can we? Okay, yes. I had to look these up too. So, dimensionality. Attributes per object. Okay, let's go a little deeper. Here's my data set. I have rows and columns. My rows are objects. I have people. I have lots of people. I could have 100 people or 1,000 people or 10 million people. Lots and lots of rows. That's fine. But dimensions are the attributes, the things I know about those people. So I know your name. That's an attribute. I know your address. I know your recency, frequency, and monetary value. I know your website behavior. I know your mobile phone number. That's a lot of attributes. And if I have 10 attributes, okay, that's just a structured data set. If I have 1,000 attributes or 10,000 attributes, oh, that's too much. The brain can't handle it. Now we talk about cardinality, options per attribute, and that's the yellow dot. If that is your age, then it is limited to 0 to 125. That's all it could be. If it's your phone number, 7 billion people, 7 billion phone numbers, that's very high cardinality. So if I have lots and lots of attributes, and any given attribute could have lots and lots of possibilities, that's where the human brain just melts. We can't do that. Too many permutations, too many possibilities. The machine's great. Machine loves that kind of thing because it's just number crunching. Okay? So that's what it's good at. What do we use it for? We use it for marketing, starting, of course, with robots, because robots, we love them. If you go to this hotel in Japan, this robot will check you into the hotel. Unless you go to the next counter over, and this robot will check you into the hotel in Japan. And then if you're hungry for a midnight snack, this robot will bring it to your room. So that's not quite marketing, that's more branding. Marketing is where you walk into a store. This is a hardware store in California where the robot greets you and says, "What are you looking for?" And you can say, "I need a kitchen sink." And it says, "Follow me. I know where the kitchen sinks are." And as it's going down the aisle, it's doing inventory control on both sides as well. And then it gets to the kitchen sinks and say, "Here they are. Can I help you with something else?" "Yes, what colors do they come in?" "Oh, well, here's all the colors." "Well, how do I know it's going to fit in the space that I have available?" "Oh, let me get a human being for you." So it knows its limits. That's good. So robots. And they're trying it out in almost a dozen stores to see how customers like it. We're not sure yet. Computer vision is very useful for marketing. This is a company that looks for your logo on social media. And when it finds it, it records it, and then it tracks a lot of things about your logo showing up in the wild. So what's the age group of people walking around with your can of Coca-Cola? Who are your top influencers? What are your competitors doing? Would you like to license that particular picture for your own advertising? Or would you like to look for more examples of it and advertise against it? So that's a system that's been around for about 4 years now, and they're doing very well. Computer vision is also good for augmented reality. So here's where you can find things. Here are the prices of things on the shelves. Here's additional information you can't see. So with the phone, I can look at the flat picture and see the three-dimensional model. With the phone, I can look at the product label and get recipes. So that's solid marketing, solid value. So we've got computer vision, we've got facial recognition, because, well, how about outdoor advertising? Or, sorry, first we'll go to online. Warby Parker, the eyeglasses, says, "We'll take a picture of your face and recommend which glasses would look best on you." And Moscow Billboard, "Target ads based on the kind of car you're driving," or "only shows billboards to women." So we're using facial recognition already. I saw one in Milan 2 days ago where you step in front of the camera and it says gender and age within 4 or 5 years, even as you're walking by. So it's that quick to be able to recognize some dimensions about human beings. And then language. You talk to your phone. You talk to your voice device at home. You ask Alexa to do things, and by golly, she does. You ask Siri for the weather or to buy tickets, and it can, because so many people are using this that we have taught the computer how we speak. Every time you correct it, it learns. And then chatbots, which are, honestly, they're going to get better. I promise they will right now. But there's limited cases where there's value. How much did I spend on Uber in September? And that's just, okay, that's a table lookup. That's fine. How about October? Now, that's a really complicated problem because the computer had to remember the context of the conversation, that we were talking about Uber, we were talking about how much I spent, and asking the question, how about October, requires higher level cognition to go back up and go, oh, that's what he meant, and then give me the numbers for October. Here's a company that has a unique user interface and a unique piece of machine learning to solve a common problem, which is scheduling meetings. If I want to go to lunch with you next week, I'll send you an email and I will copy Amy at x.ai. And Amy will look at my calendar and say, well, I'm not available Monday or Tuesday, so Thursday or Friday are good, and will email you and say, what's better, Thursday or Friday? And you say, well, Thursday, and we should go to this restaurant. And Amy looks at my calendar and sees, I have a meeting until 11:45, and I can't get across town to that restaurant. So Amy will write back and say, well, how about this restaurant on Thursday or the one you like on Friday? And you make a decision. Amy updates my calendar and sends me an email saying, it's all set. The user interface is email. It's not an app, it's just email. And Amy fools people. People have sent Amy flowers to the office to say thank you for your help setting up this meeting. So it is an extremely narrow application. It's a very narrow thing, you know, problem to solve. And the problem is not figuring out the calendar or looking at when you're available or learning that you don't like to have meetings on Monday morning or Friday afternoon. Or learning that when you have a doctor's appointment, you need extra time to get home first and then go to the doctor. She learns all that. The hard part is communicating with humans. Because humans' language is just strange. And they have spent 8 years, $42 million, and 200 people solving this problem. Here is Google guessing what you are going to type in your email. Hi, Jacqueline, haven't seen you in a while, and hope you're doing well. Let's get together soon. So it is guessing what the end of the sentence is going to be. And it can take, it knows that it's Taco Tuesday, so it's going to be about tacos. How about next Tuesday, around 6, at my place? And here's my address. Now, I've talked to people who are using this, and they say it's pretty remarkable. It does this, and it does learn how you speak and what language you use when you type. So it is paying attention. It is a machine that is learning. Lenovo took their customer data set, their customer intelligence data set, and hooked it up to a white label of Alexa, and created a user interface for senior executives. And I'm going to let Lenovo tell their own story here with a video. Can we get the audio on this? Can we get the sound? Let's go back. And we're looking for the sound here. He's finding the right cable. Okay, good. We got it. So let me go back, start it over. Bing. Thank you.
A few years ago, we created Lucy Sky. Lucy stands for Lenovo Unified Customer Intelligence, which is our big data analytics platform. Lucy is on the cloud, and hence we call it Lucy Sky. On top of Lucy Sky, we built hundreds of different dashboards. But what we realized was that many of our executives kind of needed information in near real time. They really didn't want to go to a dashboard to get the answer. We used a partner of ours, Blue Ocean Market Intelligence, to actually help us bridge Lucy Sky and Lenovo Smart Assistant. So what that means is our executives can get answers to business questions a lot quicker and make decisions in real time. We could ask questions like, hey Lucy, what's total shipped units this quarter?
The total shipped units this quarter are 248,500 units.
Hey Lucy, what's total shipped revenue this quarter?
The total shipped revenue this quarter is $108,600,000.
Lucy, am I cooler than YY?
No, Ashish, you are probably high on something.
Lucy, what am I high on?
Lucy in the Sky with Data, and here is a song I recommend.
Lucy in the Sky.
Yeah, and it gets silly from there. So that's fun. It is kind of a toy for your executives so they can feel cool. But the real value that came out of it was that it cut the ad hoc questions from senior executives into the analytics team by 35%. So the analysts could actually do real analysis instead of just answering stupid questions from senior people, because that's, how many people came to my web page? It's like, no, go ask the machine, right? Very valuable. Here's another example. This is a company called Staples. They are an office supply company. And about 20 years ago, they came up with an advertising campaign of, we make your life so easy that it's like pushing the easy button. And then they came up with a toy that was the easy button with a battery in it and recording that you hit it and it goes, that was easy. It's annoying, but you know, they could sell their marketing to you. And then they took it a step further. And so here's a video about that.
It's just a blue pen, right? Sounds simple, but it's surprisingly complex. What brand? What type? What quantity? Now magnify that across the chaos of all the stuff you order for all the people in your office. What if managing this was as easy as saying,
hey, please tell me what you need.
Blue pens.
Now it is. That's the magic of the Staples Easy System.
Hey.
Using simple spoken words.
Any more post-it notes?
The easy button lets you order everything your team needs to be productive, fed, and caffeinated.
French vanilla coffee and letter-sized copy paper.
Got it. That was easy.
It's an extra set of hands, helping you save countless hours, manage costs, and maintain control of ordering supplies.
Three boxes of Sharpies.
The Staples Easy Button brings the power of on-demand to businesses on any device. Exactly when something is needed.
Dry erase markers.
Order with voice through the easy button or through the app. Order with a text, with an email, with a Slack bot, with a photo, or even with Facebook Messenger. It's easy to track shipments.
I need to check on my order.
And get in touch with customer service. The brain behind the easy system is IBM Watson. Watson's cognitive intelligence turns what you say into data, and then turns that data into answers you need. The Staples Easy Button learns over time. With every interaction, it becomes more personalized and more intuitive.
Please tell me what you need.
So when you tell the Easy Button you want blue pens, it knows the exact blue pens you want.
Got it. That was easy.
That's the Staples Easy System.
So when you take machine learning and combine it with voice recognition and computer vision, and it begins to come together in ways that make marketing and customer service sort of the same thing. So, exciting technology, fun stuff. How do you make it happen for you? So, a few ideas about onboarding. But first of all, And clearly this does not apply to anybody in this room, because you're in this room. You are already good at analytics. So good for you, you're ready for artificial intelligence. Number one, really clear goals. Because it's not general intelligence. You can't tell it, you know, the four main things that business wants to accomplish. Raise revenue, you know, make more, spend less, make my customers happy, and do things more efficiently. You can't just tell the machine, hey, raise revenue. That's not going to work. And even if you get specific about, oh, well, all we need to do is raise awareness or improve the interaction with our clients, our prospects, yeah, no, that's not specific enough. We've got to get really specific. So in the world of data science, there is the apocryphal tale of the paperclip factory. And they made it fully automated and fully machine learning and AI oriented and said, optimize the production of paperclips. So the machine looked at shop floor control and supply chain management, and then it realized that it needed more money in order to build another factory. So it went off and improved marketing. And then it went and studied how to manipulate the stock market so it could make more money. And then it studied hypothetical physics so it could turn every molecule on the planet Earth into a paperclip. Wrong problem to solve. We didn't give it a specific enough. And even if I ask it to just raise revenue, it'll say, well, that's fine. Sell 20 euro bills for 1 euro and revenue will go through the ceiling. It'll be great. No, wrong problem to solve. So we have to get very specific. Even optimized customer retention has too many moving parts, right? We've got to talk about something very particular like more opens on my email or more clicks on my banner ads, something really specific. And now a word of warning. When you bring this stuff in, make sure upper management is prepared for disappointment. Because the machine has to learn. So humans are doing their optimization thing. They're bumping right along. They're making improvements. That's fine. And then you bring in a machine learning system, and it just goes right to hell. Because it doesn't know anything. It has a brand new data set. It has a brand new problem to solve. And it didn't learn, it didn't remember anything from where it learned before, because it doesn't work that way. And then it figures it out. It's like a baby taking a step and falling down, and taking two steps and falling down, and then taking, oh, and now it's out the door and down the street. That's what machine learning does. Suddenly it gets it. And when it has completely optimized that problem with that data set, it goes back to this sort of plateau. So be warned that at first it's dumb as a rock. And then it gets brilliant, and then it just becomes average. So what do? You give it a new problem or fresh data. And then it continues to be an amazing, powerful system. Okay, so that's number one, clear goals and be prepared. Next is the value of data quality is enormous with this stuff because it's a little bit of a black box, and you want to trust it, so you absolutely have to trust the data that goes into it. It can't evaluate data quality itself. That's your responsibility. So it has to be clear, consistent, and reliable. And if somehow there's a data stream that we missed something, there was 2 hours where there was no signal, or, well, who knows? There's all kinds of problems it could be. Somebody misconfigured the tag. Somebody forgot to tag it altogether. Maybe there was just some sort of integration error with the extract transform load. And oh, by the way, that's one data stream. You're responsible for a whole bunch of touch points. There's data coming in from all over the place. And when you've got that many data streams coming in that you're relying on, it's really difficult to see that you've got a couple of problems there. So you need a data steward watching each data stream. And when those data streams hit the data lake, that is where the magic happens. If this is all clean, consistent, and reliable, then machine learning, the robots, can come in and help you find interesting things in that data lake. But you really need to make sure that you've got this clean, consistent, and reliable, and yes, there is a human aspect that's the machine's not gonna help you with, and that is bias in the data. Amazon recently admitted, and this is a problem that we've seen coming a long time, Amazon recently admitted that they had to throw away a model they built for recruiting because it asked the machine to look at the thousands of resumes they get every day and pick the ones who are most likely to be successful in the company. Well, the machine says, what does success look like? Well, the most raises, the most promotions, the longest in the company, the most direct reports, that's success. And it says, oh, okay, old white guys. That is bias baked in the data. So you are responsible for that. Fortunately, the machine can help you with a whole bunch of that other stuff if you are very comfortable with your data. And I'm one slide. Ah, there we go. That's the one I wanted. NAT Internet helps with that as well with the new Dataflow API and the Dataflow app. It is doing data quality. They've got the tag checker. Yep, that's absolutely necessary. But then monitoring the data flow that comes in, critical to having high confidence in your data. All right, where do you start? Things that are repetitive with lots and lots of data and low risk. So anything that is ranking or sorting or finding anomalies, like they do in Explorer, that's magic. That's where the machine can help a lot. And there we go. The machine is really good, not at analysis, but at correlation and segmentation and anomalies. Show me something interesting in Explorer, and then you drill down to find out how valuable that is, how interesting that is, how useful that is. Then the question is, well, gee, should I buy this or build this? Well, I have a strong opinion about that, and let's talk about how this all works. It's all about the business stakeholder, the decision maker. The decision maker is going to use their domain knowledge, whether it's about the products, the customers, the competition, the environment, and they're going to use all of that information to set business goals, to identify problems, and to make business decisions. That's their job. Now, what we want is for them to make business decisions based on insights that we deliver. Great. So that means we have to get the analyst involved. And the analyst has to appreciate and understand the business goals and problems in order to create hypotheses to test. So I think this is the problem, and I think this is a solution. Let's test it out. Great. So the analyst is going to work with the data scientist. They're going to determine what data might be the most revealing, account for cognitive bias, and boy, there's a whole nother hour's worth of presentation. Go Google that. That's your brain, like, messing with you, and it's all between your ears. And account for innate bias, the bias that's in the data, in order to give sound advice back to the business decision maker, so that they can make a data-informed decision, right? With lots of interaction between analyst and business stakeholder. The analyst is going to work with the data scientist, who has to figure out what methods to use to build models. And they are going to depend on the data engineer, who's responsible for making sure the data is trustworthy and valid and high quality. Lots of feedback between the data scientist and the data engineer. Lots of feedback with the analyst, and the data engineer is going to improve data quality so that the decisions, the recommendations that go to the business stakeholder are valid and useful. So that's a lot of stuff going on. Do you need to hire a data scientist and a data engineer? Well, you know, these positions all overlap. And if you find one person who can do all of these things, we have a word for them. They do not exist. If you are Microsoft and IBM and Apple and Amazon, then yeah, you need to hire those people and compete at enormous expense with your competitors. But for the rest of us, the data scientist and the data engineer, those are areas that are really good for outsourcing. If you can find companies like maybe AT Internet that have data scientists and are building these systems to help you do your work, that's where you should go. That's the step to take, because you have a unique data set. They have the ability to put together the data scientists and the data engineers to help you get it done. So buy versus build, I say buy, because you can't afford a data scientist. You have to decide which data sets are useful. If you give the machine too much variety, confidence goes very low. It's all just noise. If you give it too little, it is absolutely sure, and it will be wrong. So if I flip a coin three times and it comes up heads three times, 100% confidence that the next flip will be heads. No, sorry. Doesn't work that way. So there is the right amount of data, and that's something that only you can know as an analyst with business domain knowledge. And then the smell test. We are not going to be able to teach machines this. You need to decide what problem we're going to solve. You need to decide what data is going to be considered. And you need to decide if the output from the machine makes sense. I want to optimize email opens and clicks. So email opens and clicks. Yes, you want to optimize response? Fine. Send 250,000 emails to each of your customers every hour. You'll get response. that does not pass the smell test. And the smell test, you can't explain it, but a human can just look at the something and go, yeah, no, that's not going to work. No, 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 no. I know how this happened. I understand. I'm going to go find the people and fire them. But come on, folks. Let's use some common sense. This, the be human part, that's your job. The be human part, that's where you stand above the machine. The machine is brilliant at lots of data, going through it quickly, finding things that are unique. The cost is low. They don't have opinions. They don't have sick days. That's great. But they also don't have common sense and reason and emotion, which is an amazing tool that evolution has given us, even though we've figured out how to Facebook it into voting for the wrong people. Sorry. I do feel better after yesterday's election, though, I got to tell you. You have the ability to recognize whether it's the right problem to solve. You have the ability to see one thing and think about how that applies to another. You can watch a bird fly away and think, oh, I have an idea of what I should put in my PowerPoint for tomorrow's meeting. Nothing to do with birds, but it just something clicked. This is amazing thing that humans have is empathy and imagination, and what happens between your ears is astonishing, and that's what you should make use of the most. Because computers are incredibly fast and accurate, but stupid. Humans are slow and inaccurate, but we are brilliant. So we have found that when we put them together, we get amazing results. So be human, but be prepared for how marketing is about to change wildly. It's going to get really weird. My job is to look over the horizon and see what's coming. So here's what I see. I see that I, as a consumer, am going to have my own agent who works for me, and it won't be Microsoft, it won't be Google, it won't be Siri. It's going to be my personal agent that knows everything about me, and that's okay because it will be secure, maybe because of blockchain, because somebody had to say blockchain today, right? And it is going to serve me. Now imagine how this might work. I'm driving down the street, and the dashboard, the light goes on the dashboard that says there's a fault in the airbag. And I look at that and I wonder, and my personal assistant, who I will name Jeeves, pipes up and says,
pardon me, sir.
Yes, Jeeves?
The airbag light is now lit.
Yeah, I saw that. Like, what is that?
Of the 63 things that could be wrong, the most common is a misconnection in the wiring harness. It will cost $150 for a diagnostician to determine if that's the case. Finding the unplugged wire and securing the connection will run about $3,500 at the dealer.
No, 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 no.
Yes, it's expensive. They must remove the seats, uncover all the wiring to find and fix the fault, and then reassemble the car. Your air conditioning system is also down to 72% efficiency.
Yeah, but I can just get that recharged, right?
Yes, but you've done that twice already in the past 3 months, and its failure rate is increasing.
Okay, so what will it take to bring this car up to snuff?
$3,500 for the airbag wiring. Nearly $300 to get the air conditioning tested and recharged, yeah. And another $500 for new tires will get this car up to snuff for another month. But your failure rate is increasing.
Yeah, you said that already. So what do you suggest?
I suggest that 175,000 miles over 15 years is a decent return on your investment. The time has come to consider a replacement. I've heard you talking with Colleen about wanting to simply replace this vehicle with the latest model. I have found 3 auto dealers in town who have the model you want. I've negotiated with all 3, and while the silver one is $52 more, it is available and can be delivered this afternoon. The dark gray one will take an extra week, but you'll be at the Marketing Analytics World Conference all next week. Shall I have the silver one delivered today?
You know, I really should talk to Colleen about this first.
Colleen says,
"You know, Jeeves, I haven't felt all that safe in that ancient car of his when we drive out to the desert. And with the air conditioning going out, it's time."
So, like, she's okay with the fact that I want the high-end model with all the cool tech things in it?
Colleen says,
"If he's going to drive his new car for 15 years, he should get the one he wants."
Aww. Jeeves, ask her if she'll marry me.
Sir, you've been married for more than 36 years.
Yeah, so Jeeves, you remember last week when I wanted to send flowers, and it wasn't her birthday, and it wasn't our anniversary?
Is this another lesson about romance?
Yeah, that's it exactly. Okay, so, will she marry me?
Colleen says,
"Oh, you know I'd marry him again any day. Can't wait to see his new car."
Well, me too. When can it be delivered?
They'll have it in your driveway at 4:30, after the dental appointment you are about to be late for.
Jeeves, did you just end a sentence with a preposition?
Trying to blend in, sir.
Yeah, good luck with that one. Okay, can you, like, do all of the paperwork for me, too?
Already done, sir.
Yeah, of course. Well, Jeeves, thank you.
One is pleased to be of service.
Okay, that was a reference to the Robin Williams movie Bicentennial Man, right?
Well spotted, sir.
Yeah. And that's marketing. That's what you're going to be doing in a few years, building systems that can talk to systems. You're going to be responsible for figuring out what the problem is you're trying to solve, and that is talking to customers. You're going to have to take advantage of the tools. You'll have to build systems that can talk to systems. And because we've got this verbal stuff, you're also going to have to build your brand like never before. Because when I say, "Alexa, send me AA batteries," I get Amazon-branded batteries. I have to say, "Send me Duracell batteries." You have to make sure your brand is top of mind, or my system is not going to deliver it properly. So you have to figure out what your next step is. What specific problem can you solve? Which tools can you use? How do you try this out so you can learn more and you'll be ready to do marketing in an AI world? Thank you.